again, thank you all for weathering the storm, as it were, to get here. This is the annual Heron Allen Lecture. Those of you who have been before know that we only have the most wonderful speakers, a tradition that we're going to continue tonight. Our speaker tonight, John Vucetich, is a very smart man. And you're just about to discover that. I have never found it in my wit to say anything that he found even slightly unexpected until yesterday, when as we arrived in LMH, I said to him, you know, they're thinking of cancelling the lecture. And he said, why? I said, because of the snow. And for the first time ever in my interaction with John, he looked bewildered. And he said, what snow? I said, that snow. I said, oh, that snow. Yes, I've got slightly over 5 foot of that in my garden at home. So, anyway, it's been my only time to say something sufficiently surprising. But John is a remarkable man. He started life as a biologist, but an extremely quantitative one. He can, as they say, count. He also can do field work and big time. Most of you will know of a remarkably interesting population of wolves, which on Isle Royale he has been part of a dynasty of biologists studying under difficult, challenging field conditions and combining that with his quantitative skills to gain insights. That would be enough for us to welcome him here tonight. But remarkably, close to unique as a practicing field biologist, John decided to retrain himself in classical argument and in formal ethics. So he becomes one of the only, perhaps the first, conservation ethicists in the world. So tonight we're going to hear a talk which I believe takes account of his understanding of quantities, his feeling for natural history and ecology and fieldwork within a framework of understanding ethics. John, you're very, very welcome indeed.
We'll get into things straight away. The first thing that I want to do is take you to the part of the world that I come from, which is the Lake Superior region of North America, a place that has all the snow at the moment. And in Lake Superior is an island, Isle Royale National Park. And on this island are wolves and moose. And the wolves and moose live essentially in a single predator, single prey system. The moose die basically from only one of two causes. They die of starvation from time to time, and otherwise they're killed by wolves. Wolves have only one supply of food, and that's the moose population. This is also the site of the longest predator-prey system in the world. It's going on its 60th year next year. I've been working with the study for about 25 years. I've been responsible for its leadership for about the last 15 years. And what I want to do now is just tell you a little bit of the science that we've learned, but really just in almost in passing, but just it'll provide a little context for you, I think. Some of the things that we've learned now are taken to be common knowledge about wolves. The notion that wolves are selective predators, the fact that they can't just kill any old moose or prey that they like, that they really are partial to the ones that are older or disabled in some ways. That seems like everybody knows that, but it was learned for the first time on Isle Royale in the 1970s. Trophic cascades. There was a time in the mid-1990s where ecologists were wondering whether marine systems and aquatic systems were maybe the only places where trophic cascades occurred. No one had observed one in a terrestrial system before. In the mid-1990s, Isle Royale and the wolves and moose there are the first documented case of a trophic cascade on a terrestrial system. We've also done work to understand why it is that wolves, which are social creatures, that's kind of a conspicuous trait for a carnivore, why it is that they live in groups. We have also, over the years, performed many net proxies on moose. We're up to something like a number 6,000 in something or another. And whenever we do that, we collect some of the bones. One of the things that we've learned from doing this has to do with arthritis, which is a senescent-related disease for moose, and its life history and how that scales up and has impacts on the population dynamics for predator and prey. Also, for these moose, we have, by taking moose that are born in different years over the last six decades, and then by analyzing the mercury that ends up being deposited in their teeth, which comes from the food that they eat, been able to learn about long-term spatial and temporal patterns of deposition of mercury. In addition to being a place where we've learned a lot about Isle Royale, it's also an important place in terms of conservation, because the kind of place that Isle Royale is a place where there is not logged at all. This time series right here, that part of the time series, and you can see recently they've not been doing well. They're down to just two wolves right now. It's fully expected they'll go extinct soon, and I want to give you a little bit of insight about that, what is now just imminent extinction. And I want to focus on this period of time because it has to do with, it's a lead up to the extinction that occurs now. And that period of time is a time when there was one particular wolf that was alive. He acquired the nickname, the Old Gray Guy. He's pictured up there at the top in the middle. We know about his identity because he was easy to pick out. For wolf biologists, most wolves, especially in the part of the world where I come from, where they're all in the gray phase, they all kind of look the same. It's only the exceptional wolf that you can tell apart. And this one you can tell, he's bigger than all the other wolves. He's got different colored pelage, and so we can keep track of him. His identity also was distinctive, and he was one of the most successful wolves ever to live on Isle Royale in terms of reproductive output. He led one of the most successful packs to ever live on Isle Royale, and that manifests itself in various social dynamics and population biology that were all pretty impressive. But the one thing that we did not know about him until 2010, long after he died, was his heritage, where he came from. Turns out through genetic analysis that we did kind of in a after the fact sort of matter, that we discovered he had come from Canada. And that was important because up until 2010, we and our colleagues had fully believed that for all these decades on Isle Royale, the population had been completely isolated and also consequently suffered great inbreeding, and at the same time appeared to suffer no negative impacts from that, didn't seem to demonstrate any signs of inbreeding depression. Especially in the 1990s and early part of the 2000s, that became fodder for folks who thought that maybe genetics were not a terribly important part of population biology. Well, in any event, what I want to do is tell you a little bit about what we learned about that genetics. It'll weave into a larger narrative that I'm going to tell you here in just a moment. I want to refer to ancestry. Ancestry is a population genetics concept. It's the idea, imagine all of the genes in a gene pool, and then just ask what portion of the genes in that gene pool trace back to a particular individual. For most individuals in a population, it'll be a very small amount. And what I'm going to show you here in this graph, it's an inset graph, and so the x-axis along the bottom of that blue part is going to match up with the time that's right here, and the vertical axis is going to show you ancestry of the Old Gray Guy. And this is it. And so within 2.5 generations, about 10 years' time, his ancestry rose to 0.6. That means 60% of all the genes in the gene pool for this population trace back to him. It shows, demonstrates rather definitively, how successful he and his lineage was compared to the lineage of native Isle Royale wolves. It's the most definitive way to show that the fitness of the Isle Royale wolves had in fact been impaired, they had in fact been suffering inbreeding depression all along, we just overlooked it. Now the only way that that wolf could be so successful is if there was also inbreeding occurring within his lineage, and you can only have so much of that and things will turn sour. His ancestry starts to decline for that reason, and that marks the kind of final stages of the wolf population also plummeting on the whole. Now, I mentioned that he was an immigrant from Canada. How did he get there? Oh, I'm sorry, one more thing first. In terms of just some of the kind of basic science, we wrote a series of papers on the topic. The two most interesting papers are marked here, and we put this in the framework of kind of better understanding genetic rescue on the whole, because it's a potentially important tool for conservation genetics. I mentioned that this wolf, this Old Gray Guy, had come from Canada. Well, how does that happen? On Isle Royale, basically, the only way for a wolf to get to Canada is to walk there at times when an ice bridge is present. It's about 25 kilometers or so, the passage of water that you can see there between Isle Royale and the mainland. And it freezes from time to time, not every winter, some winters, and sometimes when it freezes, it may be for a week or two, and sometimes it might be for a month or two. Now, one of the things that myself and my colleagues have been doing for a long time, we do it in part because it's easy. You've got to keep in mind the folks who started doing this in the 60s had no idea how valuable this very simple observation is. You're flying around, you look out the window and say, is there ice all the way to the mainland or not? And in the years in which there was ice going all the way back to the mainland, we put a dot up at the top of the graph. In years when there was no ice bridge, we put a dot at the bottom of the ice bridge, not knowing until recently why we were doing it and keeping track of it so diligently. And if you perform logistic regression on this set of numbers, what you realize is that it's easy to see from just the pattern of dots. The frequency of ice bridges have been declining. In the 1960s, ice bridges occur in about 3 out of every 4 years. Now they're down to about 1 in every 10 years, of course, because of climate warming. Now, when we learned about these ideas about the old gray guy and the genetic benefit that he created for the population, remember that's all just in like the last 15 years of the population, it made us wonder whether there were maybe things going on in the prior decades that we had overlooked or neglected. And so basically by just, first of all, tending to some of the genetic materials that we have from those earlier stages, earlier time periods, which aren't as much, but they're something. And then actually also just really taking very careful re-examination of old field notes. We now have good reason to believe, and we've published the explanations, you saw it in one of the papers that I cited a couple of slides ago, I have reason to believe that immigrants have been coming maybe on the order of once every 10 or 15 years. And so, there are fewer immigrants now, the population suffering from this inbreeding, and it has led to this question about whether wolf predation on Iowa should be restored or not. And this is a question for which the stakeholders of this question would be all of the citizens of the United States, because this is a national park. And if it were only about wolves, it still would be kind of a narrow question, though. What has been the case is that in the United States, this has become a referendum, I think is probably the best way to describe it, on a much broader question, which is about whether we should protect our national parks from climate change when it's possible to do so. So if climate change, we think it might take something away from the park, should we fight that, combat that, try to protect what's in there, or do we just say that's the new world we live in and let it be? So it's a relatively big question. With respect to the wolves, where a lot of people have offered their thoughts about what should be done, there basically have been two answers. And one of the answers is to say yes, and we should reintroduce wolves, and the reason for doing so is to protect ecosystem health. Okay, well, if this is the reason, it begs kind of a simple question, well, what exactly do you mean by ecosystem health? That might help us evaluate that idea. And if ecosystem health is one of these ideas that there are as many definitions of it as there are authors who have written about it, but if you study the literature and kind of think about them carefully, most definitions fall into one of two camps. And one camp says that ecosystems are healthy when they serve our needs. And the other idea that is out there, that's the next most common idea, is that ecosystems are healthy when they're unaffected by humans. Now the first idea has some merit, there's important insight there, for sure. At the same time, it's also anthropocentric. It's really only about humans. The second idea also has some insight and some merit, but it's also essentially, at its heart, misanthropic. It basically makes humans the bad guys. Let's look at the other answer, which is no. And the reason that's usually tied to folks who say that we shouldn't restore wolves, I'm not sure the disposition of folks in the room here, but this is a harder idea for me to appreciate. I can defend it reasonably as well as anyone else can, but I've never really warmed up to this idea. But I have to tell you, it's a vigorously defended idea. It's not in the majority of folks, but the folks who think this think about it passionately. What lies beneath this idea that we should let nature take its course on islands, populations go extinct, that's just what happens. If you really look at the core logic that's tied to it, it's associated with something that's referred to as an appeal to nature, which is classified officially, according to logicians, as a logical fallacy. And it's relatively easy to see the fallacious nature when you express it in its most generic form, which is to say that X is natural, what is natural is good, therefore X is good. Okay? So if something's to be good, you have to have more evidence than to merely say that it's natural. The other thing that comes from this kind of reasoning is that you have to confront this idea that humans and nature are either fundamentally separate or they are one and the same, and then you have to side on the notion that they're fundamentally separate. That's the only way that you can come to this conclusion that we should let nature take its course in a case like this. And probably neither side of that dichotomy, fundamentally separate or one and the same, is very sound. So we have these two ideas, yes, we should, and no, we shouldn't. And I'm not so sure that either idea is sitting on especially firm ground. And so of all of the things that I have been privileged to learn about the world through the wolves in Moose of Isle Royal, I think it might be that we don't have an especially solid understanding of what ecosystem health is, at least to the point that it's certainly affecting how we think about some management decisions. Now, the talk that I'm going to give today is a series of vignettes, and I've just finished the first one. And I'll mark them by these little purple circles over here so you can help keep track. And at first, the vignettes will seem to be a little disconnected, but it won't be too long where you'll see how they all come together. And now we'll start the second vignette, which has to do with some of my experiences in restoring Mexican wolves. In North America, wolf taxonomy is controversial and complicated in a legitimate kind of scientific sense. The parts that I'm going to show you today are pretty reasonably accepted. There are probably something like 5 taxonomic groups of wolves in North America, and one of them would be Canis lupus baleyi, or the Mexican wolf. They used to live in the places that are in the southern part of North America, the part that's marked in orange there. This is one of the most endangered canids in the world. There was a period of time where there were none in the wild. Today there are about 50 in the wild, and there are about 300 living in captivity in zoos around the world. This creature is protected by the United States Endangered Species Act. And what that means is that one of our agencies, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, is responsible for administering that act on behalf of Mexican wolves. And one of the responsibilities in doing so is to convene a recovery team. And one of the responsibilities of a recovery team is to develop recovery criteria. And so this is basically to ask, what are the conditions under which red wolves would have to exist, I'm sorry, the Mexican wolves would have to exist at, and then we would say they no longer need special protections. They would no longer qualify as an endangered species. So about almost 20 years ago, I was asked to be on this recovery team. It was the first opportunity I had to serve the public in the most practical way in this kind of professional sort of setting. And so I didn't know much about recovery teams. This was the first time I had been on one. And I realized they were populated mostly by a bunch of scientists, population biologists, and then you quickly start talking about population biology, which I liked that. I was pretty interested and keen about that. I also understood that I had, at that time, I'd never read the Endangered Species Act. And I thought, well, maybe before I show up to the meeting, I should read it. And when I got to meeting, I realized I was only one of 2 other biologists in the room who had taken the time to read it. And what struck me in reading it is the legal definition of the endangered species. Now, I realize what I'm sharing with you today is especially American-centric, but there is certainly some generality that we're going to find here in this American law. The legal definition is written on the screen here. It's a species that is at risk of extinction throughout all or a significant portion of its range. When I read that, I thought, first of all, that's awfully awkward grammar. Second thing that I thought is, I said, I kind of think I understand what that means, but I'm not sure. And certainly somebody else has thought about this. This is an act that at this time had been around for 25 years. This isn't the first time someone had asked, what does that mean exactly? It turns out it probably was one of the first times somebody had asked what it meant. And so what I asked is, I said, well, what is an endangered species? How in the world would we know when Mexican wolves are not endangered if we can't say what an endangered species is in the first place in general? The biologists in the room were mostly befuddled, and there were some top-level government officials that were in the room. They were there to kind of guide us and steer us in a certain way. I didn't realize at the time that this touched on some sensitivities that they had. They asked me to stop talking like that, and so I didn't take too kindly to it, so I wrote a paper about it. It's written right there. And it turns out in the time that's passed since then, this paper has become fodder for about 10 lawsuits for which the Fish and Wildlife Service has lost every one of, basically over their interpretation of the Endangered Species Act. Now, let's set aside a little bit from conservation and let's just talk about population biology and science for a moment. How do scientists talk about extinction risk? One of the ways to think about it is on a graph like this. This is one of the most complete ways to describe extinction risk. You have a graph, 2 axes, one is time, and the other is the risk of going extinct over that time frame. And so as a biologist, you can study a population, all of its demography and its mortality rates and survival and recruitment rates and trends in those things and how many individuals there are at the moment. And if you do your quantifying properly, you might be able to say, well, this population has a 40% chance of extinction over a 50-year time frame. You can put a dot on the graph showing where its extinction risk is. Okay, that's fine. But you still have one more step to do, which is you have to draw a line somewhere on that graph. And on the one side of the line, you're going to say those are endangered species. And on the other side of the line, those are not endangered. And so what I mean to say is that to describe extinction risk is absolutely and almost purely a scientific endeavor. But to say what is an acceptable level of risk, that's not a science question, okay? And what would be especially, or what is especially frustrating about this graph is that every citizen on the planet has a say in judging what counts as too much or not enough extinction risk. This is, well, there are very few people on the planet who are qualified to understand the nature of that graph because of the probabilities and statistics and population biology that are involved. And wouldn't it be a shame if only a few people are qualified to participate in an ethical discussion for which we all have something at stake in? Of course, this made me think about, among other things, the IUCN Red List criteria. Let me just remind you about what those are all about. Of course, you might think, well, my gosh, some of what John is saying shouldn't be done, has already been done, is really quite respected. They have, and this is intended just to be a memory jog. The Red List criteria are far more sophisticated than what I'm showing here. But the point is they have categories, like endangered, critically endangered, and they have levels of risk that are stipulated, and depending on your level of risk, you'd fit in one category or another. There's a recognition that you might not have enough data for that kind of categorization, so there are other kinds of data that might be easier to get in other cases, and again, we can categorize things. What's important to know is that the architects of the Red List criteria were very explicit. They couldn't have been plainer about this, is that these Red List criteria are not ethical judgments. They were intended only to be a ranking. This category is more, and this category is less, that is all. It's not even intended to determine priorities, but just to be one of many tools to help develop priorities. While that advice could not have been given more clearly and plainly, it has too often, I think, fallen on deaf ears, and it ends up being used in what basically end up being kind of ethical judgments. And one thing that's important here, you can read about these things a little bit more in this paper here, is that withholding protection because you have insufficient resources, that's okay, that may be a decision we have to make, but that is not the same, not at all, is understanding whether we had an obligation to protect in the first place. And that's one of the things that's lost in not keeping these distinctions clear. Anyway, so I started to wonder a little bit if we have this scientific way of thinking about extinction risk. We have one example from the United States Endangered Species Act, which is intentionally normative. And also, if you can get past the bad grammar, it might be a little easier to understand because you're just talking about, well, what percentage of historic range is now occupied, and maybe that gives us some insight. And anyways, I worked on this with some colleagues of mine. Of course, we made some observations that here we're talking about just a taxonomic group of wolves that used to live just on those beige areas that are in the western part of the United States. They now live only in those maroon and red parks. It's about 15% of the historic range. So I don't know exactly how to interpret this definition. I don't know exactly what the boundary condition is, but this certainly doesn't mean it. This is hard to imagine that the people who wrote that law using those language, using that language, would have thought that this is a species that's no longer endangered. And of course, the reason that I point this particular example out is because this is going on in the courts right now, because the Fish and Wildlife Service says this is fine, and some folks have sued saying, man, we're not so sure that it's fine. Again, if this were only about wolves, this would be kind of a narrow interest. But as we know, range contraction is a sadly common phenomenon. And unfortunately, the color code here is absolutely reversed. On this graph, the maroon is all the places where the creature used to live, and the beige are the places where these creatures live now. It turns out that Sabalos and Ehrlich in 2002 wrote a really marvelous paper. It's probably not cited quite as often as it should be. It's one to just go check out if you have a chance. What they did is they investigated as many mammal species as was possible. This is something like 150 or 200 species. And they were able to determine that the average species had lost more than two-thirds of its historic range. It was currently living on only about a third of where it had used to live. And this means if you take any particular place on the planet and just add up all of the species that had been removed from there, it turns out there are large swaths of the Earth's terrestrial surface where, at least wise the mammals and creatures that we can study well enough, large portions of them have been lost. If you want to know what Europe looks like, which is not much better than North America and Africa, you can, again, check out Sabalos and Ehrlich. They have a map of Europe. And anyways, we could continue on down this road, but I think I have made the point that I want to make, which is if we think about the wolves in Musubaya Royal, we might not know well enough what in ecosystem health is. And if we think about the Mexican wolves, we might have a case for understanding how we might not know well enough what an endangered species is. And again, this is not to be silly. Of course, we know that panda bears are endangered, and we know that American robins, which is an extremely common bird where I come from, is not an endangered creature. We're talking about the boundary conditions, but the point that I want to make is that the boundary condition between endangered and not endangered might be big enough and blurry enough and not well enough understood that it's affecting how we conduct our conservation in a real sort of way. Everything that I gave is really in the context of an American law. If you're interested in how this might fit in with some more international schemes, you can check out this paper, which will be available in a book chapter later this year. Third vignette, and what I want to think about now is sustainability. Another one of these concepts that there are as many definitions as there are authors who have written about them, but I think, and I make the case for it in this particular paper here, a pretty useful definition, one that encompasses a large swath of what people are thinking when they think about sustainability, is that it means realizing human well-being in a socially just manner without compromising conservation. What's really important here in this definition are the three key words: human well-being, social justice, and conservation. Most understandings of sustainability are some sort of juxtaposition of those three ideas. However, depending on exactly how you define those three key concepts, sustainability could mean anything from exploit as much as we desire without infringing on our future opportunities to do so, on the one end of the spectrum, and at the other end of the spectrum, it could mean exploit as little as necessary to live a meaningful life. Both those definitions are permitted under that top definition, depending on how you define those key words. But the trouble is that each of these two lower definitions, they describe wildly different worlds. And I'm of the belief that if you don't know what direction you're aiming for, it might impair the chances of you getting there. And I think that could be a problem in this particular case. And so, let's look at each of these words. Conservation. And we might define conservation as maintaining and restoring ecosystem health and restoring endangered species. Well, we just spoke about those two key ideas, ecosystem health and endangered species, and I think I made a case that there is a point at which we might not have an adequate understanding of those ideas. And now at this point, I want to just say it would be reasonable if at least one person in the audience was thinking, oh my goodness, is all he going to do is just deconstruct definitions ad nauseum and to no end. Bear with me for just a little while longer. We are going to do a little more deconstructing, but we will assemble it all by the end of the talk here, and so you can set that possible worry aside. There are still other perils that I could fall into, but it won't be that one. What I want to do now, though, is focus on one of the other ideas, social justice. Social justice is something that many social justice theorists would characterize as the fair treatment of others judged against the principles of equality, need, and desert in terms of what it is that you might deserve. Now, of all of the words that you might think that I would pick on in that definition of social justice, the one that I'm most interested in is the word others. Who is it exactly that is the subject of social justice? That's what I want to talk about now. And I would like to bring the most of us in here. I want to also kind of provide different frames for the next 5 minutes of what I'll share, because they might just help provide context. This idea, which just says that you are entitled to fair treatment, the kind of fair treatment that comes from social justice, if you possess intrinsic value. All I want to do here is introduce a jargon, the phrase intrinsic value. If you're an ethicist, that's the jargon that's kind of most important to this conversation. I'll say more about it in a moment, but just introducing the idea. So what I want to ask ourselves is, does non-human life possess intrinsic value? This is something that ethicists have been interested in for some time, something that some conservation professionals have been interested in for a while. Other ways, framing the same idea, this is one of the more recent incarnations of this idea from the last 4 or 5 years. Should we be conserving nature for only our human sakes, or maybe also, in addition to, for nature's sake? These are also tied to what has been referred to, again, in like the last 4 or 5 years as the new conservation debate. There are ways, if you're not familiar with this debate, it's a useful one to become familiar with. If you're familiar with it, you might have Well, I don't know how you would react to it, but I have a love-hate relationship with it, because there are elements of this debate, the way it's being carried out, that are a little bit silly, but it is also a kind of debate that it will not go away until there's far more unity in the conservation community than there currently is. Anyways, the first thing to do is to just ask ourselves, in almost a jargon-like sense, what exactly is intrinsic value? That's one of the greatest hang-ups, is not knowing what the word means. And the hang-up actually can all be attributed to, this is not being terribly generous, but to the poor writing of ethicists. They haven't always written in particularly clear ways, and that has provided some troubles for the rest of us. But I think I can clear it up for the most part for what we need to know right here. Let's just start thinking about a hammer. Hammers are useful for what it is that they do. They pound nails and they pry nails. And we generally think if we lose our hammer or break it, we can go buy a new one. We can replace it. We think that hammers are important for what it is that they do. And everything that I'm describing to you is referred to as instrumental value. Again, another piece of jargon. Sometimes it's referred to as use value. Okay? So intrinsic value is any value that is above and beyond that. If you have a thing and it has values beyond what I've just kind of described here, then that's intrinsic value. We still need to probe a little bit more. So let's think about a little child that may or may not happily mow the lawn. And we say that that child is valuable for his or her own sake. That child might do useful things, might take out the trash and do the dishes, but that's not why they're valuable. And if they didn't do those things, we'd still say they're valuable. We also say that the child is valuable for what it is that he or she is, not what he or she does. We also say, this one's very important, and to kind of understand deeply what it means and to compare it with the hammer, if we lose a child, of course you can have another child, but there is no sense in which we would say the child has been replaced. Okay? And finally, if you could remember just one thing, and what's frustrated me with the ethics literature is this is the thing that's least emphasized in the ethics literature, and I think it's just their obsession with abstraction, just like every other academic discipline has that kind of obsession, is that to possess intrinsic value, what it means in the most practical sense is that it deserves to be treated with at least some concern for its own interests. If you remember that part, you will have a very intuitive understanding of intrinsic value. So, what I'm going to describe to you next is the content of this particular paper. And it turns out that there have been, in the last 15, 20 years, a number of what might be, say, challenges have been raised for why it is that nature might not possess intrinsic value. And these are challenges that have been raised by very smart people, folks who really quite know what's going on. And what I want to do is I want to review some of them and then tell you what some rejoiners to those challenges have been. The first is that it's misanthropic to think that nature possesses intrinsic value. I think this is just a misunderstanding of what some of the words mean. A misanthrope is somebody who disparages humanity, hates humanity. And it is possible for a person to love nature and hate people. It is also possible for a person to hate nature and love people. And it is also possible for a person to love both nature and people. So the first person is absolutely a misanthrope. This is very simple. The second person will be called an anthropocentrist. They care only about humans. The last person, the person who loves both, all this requires is that you are capable of caring for more than one thing at a time. And if you're capable of that, then you're more than capable of being, and this is where I think things get tough, because there isn't a good word for this person. It is simply called a non-anthropocentrist. He couldn't come up with a word that is his own. And that may have been part of the problem, I don't know. Anyways, another objection is that it's a crazy belief. Not many people actually believe that nature possesses intrinsic value. Only people who would tie themselves to trees, hippies, vegans, just crazy far-out people, that's the only kind of folks that believe that nature has intrinsic value. That simply is not true. Sociological work suggests that something like 8 out of 10 folks believe that at least some portion of nature, of non-human nature, possesses intrinsic value. The next challenge is easiest represented as a kind of question. The question is, does acknowledging nature's intrinsic value somehow mean that that value is infinite? And if it was infinite, well then boy, wouldn't it always trump the values of humans? I think the root of this is just basically kind of a conflation or misunderstanding of the two words intrinsic and infinite, and I think part of this can be laid at the feet of the writings of some ethicists, but there is an easy answer to the question. The answer is no, And the easiest way to demonstrate it is just to remind us that in our everyday, entirely human lives, we certainly have situations where values compete with one another. And when they compete with one another, we have to find ways to adjudicate them. One of the easiest examples in our personal, everyday lives is the occasional conflict between kindness and truthfulness. When they conflict with one another, we have to kind of navigate through that and make a choice. And if we choose truthfulness over kindness, it doesn't mean that we don't care about kindness. Unless we choose truthfulness every single time, and then we might begin to question, right? And we know that this is important in our public lives. Safety and freedom, both very cherished values, and sometimes they come into conflict. And this one in particular shows us that when we adjudicate them, sometimes we can do it wisely, sometimes we can do it in a most awful manner. It can be hard to do, and it's not always easy to figure out, right, in the heat of where you're doing it. But nevertheless, we're quite accustomed to holding values that sometimes compete with one another. It's not foreign, not in the least. Arbitrary. Some people think that, all right, they'll concede, yeah, okay, lots of people maybe believe that nature possesses intrinsic value, but still an arbitrary belief, you just decided it in the same way that you might decide that you like chocolate ice cream. Well, I don't like chocolate ice cream, and I don't think nature possesses intrinsic value essentially for the same kind of reason, just because that's the way that I feel. I don't think this is true. I think I can demonstrate that to you. I'm going to share with you a line of reasoning that has, I believe, been reasonably solid for something like about 200 years or so. And the basic idea is to ask this question, what is it about humans that imbues us with intrinsic value? What trait is it that we possess? And one answer to that question is that we possess certain interests. And one interest, just to take one for example, is we have an interest to avoid pain. And so that would mean that anything else that possesses that same trait would also have intrinsic value. To think otherwise would be arbitrary. And so it's pretty straightforward, I think, to say that mammals and birds all possess an interest to avoid pain. Now here I want to be a little provocative. If we were in 1980, say 30 or 40 years ago, and if we were to ask a bunch of fish biologists whether they thought fish had the capacity or had the interest to avoid pain, I think a lot of them would say probably not. And of course, we've learned a great deal in the last 30, 35 years about fish physiology. A lot of it has to do with that the central nervous systems are sufficiently different from our own. But, you know, it's kind of a hard question to understand in depth, but just to be provocative, I'll stick with maybe for a moment. And then insects. From what I understand about insects and what folks who study pain in insects, they mostly say no. At least when we talk about pain as it's understood, at least in a mammal, when you have the kind of central nervous system that we have. Anyways, so we'd say no. This is some logic that's been around for some while. Now, we could quibble with different parts of it. We could say, well, I don't think avoiding pain is the relevant trait. I think it's something else. I think it's an interest to flourish. I think that's the trait that imbues humans with intrinsic value. All right, that's fine. Well, then fish certainly have the capacity, I'm sorry, certainly have the interest to flourish, and insects do as well. And here's my point. We could disagree with points of this logic. We could change our understanding of certain facts of the matter, but nothing in any of that will be arbitrary. That would be just kind of working through the logic and trying to shore it up or change it where it needs to be changed. Now, it's not all so simple and straightforward. What I have just described to you basically requires that the thing that might possess intrinsic value has an interest. And so that admits, and I'm being a little loose with the language just to make things easy to understand here, that admits what you might call an animal welfare ethic, because animals are organisms. It would actually, it admits biocentrism, if you will, which is mostly about organisms. However, the things that conservationists are mostly interested in, species and ecosystems, most scientists would say, those are things that don't possess interests. If they don't possess interests, there's a very good chance that the logic I've just presented to you doesn't apply. If you're weak-willed and not very adventurous, you'd say, I guess that species and ecosystems don't have intrinsic value. If you're a little bit more adventurous, you would say, well, maybe there's some other logic. Maybe that's not even the best logic. Maybe there's some other reason for which we would understand that species and ecosystems have intrinsic value. The best source of reasoning on this account comes from Aldo Leopold, an important conservation thinker from the mid-20th century. Sadly, for time constraints, I don't have a chance to explain to you what his views were on it, but I will say they're not quite as solid and shored up as this logic is here, and I think there's some work to be done by folks who are interested in conservation to make sure that there's a really firm grounding in why it is that we think that species and ecosystems possess intrinsic value. The next challenge goes this way. Yeah, all right, we're debating about whether nature possesses intrinsic value or not, but it's moot. The reason that it's moot is because whether you believe it or not, we'd still end up with the same good conservation outcomes. And I don't think that's true because, well, I think I can do it by just kind of looking at the left and right sides of the screen and just kind of thinking through what would happen. If you believe that nature did not possess intrinsic value, this is another spot where I would just ask if you could let me be just a little loose with the words. The words on the screen are not quite right, but I think they get to something that's true. If the answer is no, then I think we'd be allowed to exploit nature as much as we wanted until good reason is offered for why we should refrain. But if nature possesses intrinsic value, then I think the burden of proof is shifted at least a little bit, maybe not quite as dramatically as shown here, but it would be that we would be obligated to refrain from exploiting until a good reason is offered for why. And I think what follows from that is that if the answer is no, nature does not possess intrinsic value, then sustainability, I think, ends up being exploiting nature as much as you like without infringing on our future ability to do so. And if the answer is yes, that nature possesses intrinsic value, then I think sustainability ends up being exploiting as little as necessary for meaningful life. There is no way that you could think that those two worlds would be the same place. In that regard, it's not moot. The difference is as strong as the difference between the justice system where you were innocent proven guilty versus the opposite kind. Okay, so now we're into our fourth vignette here. In doing so, what I'm going to do is keep thinking and probing a little bit more deeply about social justice. And what I'm going to do here is describe to you a paper that I have worked on with some co-authors. I think all the co-authors, this is not all the co-authors on the paper, but these are all the co-authors that I've written. And this is fortuitous, but this paper is just available just this week. You can find it on the internet. And what we were interested in this paper is thinking about social justice from the perspective of governance, governance and natural resources. And we just wanted to reflect on it and see if we could find something useful to say, essentially. And we compared our thoughts a lot with conservation conflict resolution. This is a little bit of jargon. It's a kind of governance. Somewhat more broadly, it belongs in this group of governance that's referred to as collaborative governance, which is becoming more common, more increasingly appreciated, especially in the context of natural resource management. The basic idea is you gather all the relevant stakeholders and you negotiate a solution to how it is that the natural resources would be managed. And there are a number of basic principles that underlie collaborative governance or conservation conflict resolution. One of them is that humans are the only stakeholders. If nature gets a say, it is only through one of the human stakeholders, and that's it. You'll already intuit why, at least I think that might be a challenge for us. Another principle is that it aspires to be neutral towards values. I think what happens here is that under collaborative governance, we take for granted, right, that all of the human stakeholders have intrinsic value. They're all equally valuable. I think then we make a mistake and then think, and therefore all the values they bring to the table must have equal footing as well. And of course, I could tell you some silly beliefs that I have too, and their silliness, they wouldn't have the same value that I have simply as a human being. So there needs to be, it might not always be wise to be so neutral on values. And really one of the motivations for this paper was to ask, if we're not to be neutral on values, then are there any guiding principles that would be intentionally value-laden that would be useful in a framework like this and appropriate? The other principle here is that success in these venues usually is determined by mutual satisfaction or at least concession, so that all parties say, yeah, yeah, I can kind of live with that. Now, what's interesting here is that many social justice theorists have shown many times over that concession is no guarantee that social justice has been done. That's mainly because of power dynamics is what gets in the way. So anyways, what we wanted to do is to think about if we could come up with any principles that would be intentionally value-laden that might be appropriate in this case. What we did is we thought about a fellow whose name is John Rawls. He's one of the most important political theorists of the 20th century. He's well known for, among other things, a thought experiment that he did. It actually has a history that is deeper than him, but we'll give him the credit. It's known as the original position or the veil of ignorance. And his idea is, let's imagine that you're going to convene a group of people and they are going to make up the rules for society. But in doing so, they will not know their gender. They will not know their race. They will not know their socioeconomic status. They won't know their level of education. They won't know any of those pertinents. And then they have to come up with the rules for society. If they do a smart job at it, the rules would presumably be fair to the things for which they were ignorant to. And so all that we did, the authors on this paper that I'm describing to you, is we just said, well, what if we just extended that veil just a little bit further and said you didn't know what species you were either? Because they have those other nine human species, they have intrinsic value too. They're entitled to fair treatment as well, right? At least if you believe the things I've been telling you so far. And from that, we thought that there might be this principle that no human should infringe on the well-being of others any more than is necessary for a healthy, meaningful life. All right? The first thing that I want to do here, and I want to do this part kind of quickly, mainly because I can get sidetracked on this in a way that's not so useful. This principle is not all that different from some other ideas that are extremely well vetted and very widely appreciated, some of them going back well over a century. Okay? At the same time, so it was what I think this does, and I think the co-authors agree, is that the close relationship between the boxed ideas and the principal one at the top, the boxed ideas, they give, I think, pretty solid footing to that principal one. Almost so much solid footing that you say, wow, principle one isn't even all that different than what other folks have done. Yes, yes, but at the same time, if collaborative governance were to adopt principle one, that would be a wild departure from how it is that we govern our natural resources. One more thing about principle one and this next couple ideas, I don't intend them to be judgmental. I'm just trying to describe them, although there's plenty of opportunities in a different venue, maybe we can do that. First of all, principle one is unequivocally non-anthropocentric, but at the same time, it prioritizes human well-being, so there's no way that it can be construed as misanthropic. The other thing that's important here is that there is significant imprecision, but at the same time, it's not vacuous. And a lot of that balance between imprecision and vacuousness lies in that phrase, healthy, meaningful life. If you are not familiar with studying that idea, it might seem hopelessly vacuous, but for political theorists, for psychologists, there's lots of things to work with there that are really quite concrete. We also discovered that there would be a need for at least, a second principle. And basically, the thing that we understood is that the way that principle one would play out in various venues might depend on the economic conditions that surround the principle. Imagine you have a situation where all of the needs of the stakeholders are met. This would happen in some conservation conflicts that occur entirely within developed nations. If that's the case, principle one is still true, but it's not going to be a terribly informative guide. And so that led us to develop the second principle. What I'm about to do next is very, very unfair. You're going to have to check the paper out to know what the second principle is. It's a little bit too complicated to kind of tell you about it in just one or two moments, which is all that I have now. And so if you're intrigued by principle one and you want to learn more about what principle two might be, you can fortuitously check out the paper anytime you like because it's just available this week. But I've certainly said enough to drive home what is this overarching point that I'm really quickly zooming in on, which brings us to our fifth and final vignette, which is to talk about ethics most concretely and most straightforwardly. We've been talking about ethics, obviously, all along the way, but now I want to be the most explicit about it. And of course, you know me, the definitions guy, we need a definition. And I think a pretty useful definition for ethics in an academic setting is that it is the formal analysis of propositions pertaining to how it is that we ought to behave. I'm going to demonstrate to you what that means in pretty simple terms coming up here pretty quickly. But before I do that, just reflect on a couple of statements. We ought to conserve this water resource in this way. We ought to sustain this forest in this way. Those statements, if you're a conservation biologist, those are your purview. That's what you're all about, statements of that nature. But here's the thing, is if you're an academic ethicist, you're like, no, that's my field. That's not your field, that's my field. And so here's the thing, is that whether we like it or not, conservation and sustainability, that is ethics in action. Whether we appreciate it, it is. Whether we deny it, it still is. And so it would behoove us, as conservation professionals, to probably learn something in a somewhat formal sense about the nature of ethics. Now, one of the great misperceptions about ethics, and there are a handful of them, but one of the most important ones is that ethics is really quite subjective, and that just doesn't give us much traction, just leads to frustrations, and then we kind of get turned off to ethics as a field. The antidote to this idea is to appreciate that ethics is much more strongly rooted in logic than we sometimes give credit for, and I will try to demonstrate that now. The first thing to do is to remind ourselves from like an introductory critical thinking course what it is that an argument is. An argument is just a collection of statements. The first bunches of them are called premises, and then the last one is called a conclusion. Together, they make up an argument. Now, an ethical argument is just a special kind of argument, and it's a kind of argument that can be where the conclusion, the top there, where the conclusion can be expressed using the word should or ought. If you can rewrite the sentence using the word should or ought, and if that's the conclusion, you have an ethical argument. Now, there are a couple of features about ethical arguments that are awfully convenient. The first is almost every ethical argument has at least one, often several, what would be called descriptive premises. In this kind of heuristic example, premise one is serving that role. It's a descriptive premise. We could call it an empirical premise. We could call it a scientific premise. It's just a description of the way the world is. Every ethical argument also has to have, absolutely must have, at least one premise that is of an ethical nature. That's premise two, serving that role in this case. The next thing that's very important about arguments is that there are exactly only two ways in which they can go wrong. And we can discover that by asking two questions. Are all of the premises true, and is the logical structure valid? If the answer to those two questions is yes, then the conclusion, ever since Aristotle, is rock solid. Okay? And if one of the answers to the questions is no, then there may be concerns with the conclusion. Now, this is very simple, of course. What I want to do next is show you how something like this can be applied to a more complicated real-world ethical circumstance. And so what I will do here now, part of my animation, I realize what comes up next is not quite in the right order, so I'm going to hit two things, and I'll talk about the second one first. Keep going here. What I'm going to describe to you is a paper that is in preparation right now. A number of co-authors involved, but the ones that are in the room are listed here. And this, in some places that I go and give this talk, I have to explain who Cecil the Lion is, but I think for the most part this audience probably knows. And Cecil the Lion, his death, is responsible for a kind of inflaming, because I think it had been around for a while before, inflaming a question that can be phrased variously, but the one question is, should we tolerate trophy hunting of lions to conserve lion populations? And part of the, let me just tell you like how did that question come to be and what's all going on here. I'm sure you all know lions are not doing well. And one of the things that can happen is that the places where there's trophy hunting of lions, it's a pretty lucrative business, makes lots of money, and for the landowners and land managers that are involved in that, that money may well be all the motivation that's necessary to keep that habitat in good lion habitat. So that's how the controversy comes to be. Trophy hunting lions might be necessary to conserve lions. Okay, so you need a toehold, and so let's put this argument up here only as a toehold. And so the idea of premise number one, this is the descriptive premise, the empirical one. Trophy hunting supports lion conservation. Premise two, we ought to support lion conservation. Therefore, we ought to support trophy hunting. Okay, well, so you do the only two things that you need to do with an argument, which is to ask, are all the premises true? And is the logical structure valid? Now, I'm going to do a sleight of hand and take us many, many steps forward, but I think your imaginations will serve us well here. The logical structure here is not valid. One of the ways to make it valid is to add some missing premises that aren't there. That work is not easy. It takes an awful lot of labor to think carefully about what might be true and relevant and would be needed to come to that conclusion, but isn't there. So you're looking for something that you don't know if it's there or not. Anyways, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a somewhat abbreviated form of the argument that my co-authors and I came up with. It's the argument that we wanted to inspect carefully, the argument for which we wanted to ask those two questions of about premises being true and logical valid being being valid. You can read these. Don't angst over them, though, because I'm not going to draw any conclusions that depend on the details of the premises, but just get a feel for the depth of complexity, get a feel for how many premises there are. I can tell you this one thing straight away. There are, in this expression of the argument, there are three empirical premises. The other premises are of an ethical or normative nature. Okay. I'll give you a moment to just read through those. Again, you don't want to think too hard about them. From this, I can start to draw, I think, some of the main points. The first thing to know is that every single premise in that argument has to be true in order to confidently know that that conclusion is true. Okay? If one premise is false, you don't say, well, the conclusion is 5/6 supported. It's a little bit of an all or nothing sort of thing. And one of the things that this means is that an argument, and this is an important kind of object lesson for conservation professionals who are not so familiar with ethics, an ethical claim can fail because an empirical premise doesn't hold. In premise 2, 3, and 4, you gotta understand, I'm a reasonably well-read conservation biologist, but I don't spend most of my time thinking about lions. And I was really struck by how complicated those three empirical premises are. They're not so straightforward. I know I had some misconceptions about them when I started. And I'm not so sure, the other co-authors in the room will know, I'm not so sure that the entire lion ecology community is on the same page about every one of those. They might be, I don't know, but the point is, the more important point is that this is solace for a conservation professional. If you know your empiricism well, you can contribute vitally and importantly to an ethical issue. The other thing that's really important here is that many people are unfamiliar with ethics. They think, well, all the ethical stuff, that's the part that's hopelessly intractable. But there are often times that ethical premises are not controversial. In this argument, the two least controversial premises are the ethical ones, premise number 1 and premise number 5. Now, arguments are always bound by the audience to which they're intended, and you can certainly find audience members who might not agree with premise 1 or premise 5, which is about conservation, the value of it, and the value of individual organisms. But for the vast majority of audiences, there's nothing to even talk about with premise 1 or premise 5. So ethical premises are not always controversial. But sometimes they are. And here's the next thing that's kind of important for just kind of bringing comfort, I think, to conservation professionals who might be interested to know more about ethics and how that works, is that in this particular argument, if you could remember all that new stuff that was in the last one, the one that ethical premises can be controversial. The controversial ethical premise in this argument is premise 6. A very difficult argument. I mean, very difficult premise to think about. There's two things about it. The first thing is that I think that when those unfamiliar with ethics, when they look at our argument, they immediately go to the hardest premise and they say, look, we'll never be able to solve that. And well, why would you go to the hardest one first? Go to the other 5. If any of those fail, you're done. You don't have to think about premise 6. Okay? But nevertheless, there will be occasions where maybe all the other premises check out and then you are obligated to look at the really hard one. But here's the thing, is that if we think about just the canon of Western literature, we have 2,500 years of written work to draw upon to answer premise 6. Now, granted, it's not the kind of thing where you just look up the answer in the back of the book, oh, I think Nietzsche said something about this. No, it's not like that. And you definitely, this is a spot where it would benefit to be talking with somebody who knows ethics in a really professional manner and has been trained in that sort of thing. But premise 6 is not a free-for-all. There's a lot to draw on to better understand it. This is my second from last slide. Ethics is not a silver bullet for solving our conservation problems, but at the very same time, it is absolutely essential. The other thing is that it is slow-going. My co-authors and I hope this is not a disappointment to our co-authors, we're not going to solve the problem in this paper, right? It'll still be with us, right? But that's not the point of the exercise to have completely resolved the issue. Think about, in the field of ecology that I study, how it is that predators affect their ecological communities. Ecologists have been entertaining themselves with that question for about a century, and we are no less enthusiastic about it now than we were 100 years ago. And we don't review a peer-reviewed paper and say, that doesn't solve the problem, it's rejected. We need to have a more patient attitude about how it is that ethical knowledge is developed. It's slow. As slow as the science. But there is one thing you can always expect from it for every turn, and that is that if it's been done well, it should lead to clarity and precision that was not previously there, and that is definitely in advance. Now, there were a couple of unfair things about the talk. One was in the previous vignette when I didn't tell you what principle two was. And the other unfair thing is that you all, as audience members, don't have access to this paper that I've been describing because it's in preparation still. We hope to submit it, I think, sometime in the next couple of weeks. But if you're interested in this idea, how it is that arguments can be applied to real-world problems, there are two papers here that show you that example in a relatively sophisticated manner. And so, here we are, the last slide. We've been talking about sustainability, realizing human well-being in a socially just manner without compromising conservation. We've been talking about conservation, which is about ecosystem health and endangered species. And there are two possibilities. One possibility is that our advancing sustainability and conservation is limited by our scientific knowledge. And if we only knew more science, we'd better be able to achieve those goals. The other possibility is that our achieving those goals is somehow limited by our ethical knowledge and ethical understanding. I'm sure there's no doubt that both are going to be important in advancing the realization of conservation and sustainability. But think for a moment, in the conservation community, how much resource we devote to science, the number of people, the hours we spend, the money we spend on science, and how little is devoted to advancing our ethical knowledge. That may be a misallocation of our efforts. It will be if these problems have some serious kind of ethical limitations. This is also the sort of thing where the knowledge, this ethical knowledge, it can't just reside within a few people. It's the sort of thing that the conservation community as a whole kind of has to have an understanding of. So what I hope to have done here in the time that you've been very generous to share with me is to inspire you, to convince you that number one, that you can engage in ethical knowledge, you can learn about it, and that doing so would be to great profit, not only to you, but to the community as a whole. So I would be remiss if I didn't mention some of the collaborators. Everything that I talked to you about has a number of collaborators, and the pictures would be so small if I named everybody, but some of the key people and some of the parts that they contribute to are listed here on the slide. So thank you so much for your time. It's been a great pleasure to share it all with you. I hope you enjoyed it.
Tour de force. John, I think you're prepared, even though Briggs are around the corner, to answer a few questions.
Absolutely.
Very good. Well, we have a spotlight blinding us, but if you were to gesticulate in the audience,
I think there's some interest. Would you hand that up to whoever asks a question?
Yes. Why not? Yeah. Are there any questions?
Or comments or dissents?
Let's try with the microphone to see if it can force this.
This is an important element of argument. So this is lesson number two. If you gave me a second hour. I can say very clearly. So conclusion, the thing that's marked C, is a conclusion, and the premises that are necessary to be true are all those six things. So those six things have to be true in order to come to the conclusion. So that's why we call premise six a premise. But you're very insightful to have noticed, well, how do we know that premise six is true, or how would we know? What you can do is you can pull premise six out and say, I want to treat that as a conclusion to some other argument, and what are the premises that are necessary to do that, to understand that in this case. So you're quite intuitive. Premise six can also be a conclusion at the very same time. We would have to unpack that argument.
John, can I try one?
Please.
Early on in the talk, you mentioned one of your papers that had been at the heart of at least 10 litigations, with, I think, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service.
Yes.
Lost.
Yes.
What sort of arguments did they muster, if it was the same one, against your position?
It is. Basically, so what the Fish and Wildlife Service had basically been trying to do is to deny that there's a NORAD element to it at all. And so what they said is, whatever that verbiage means in the Endangered Species Act, what it means is what scientists are referring to when they say population viability. And they refer to that as jargon. Population viability is just what's the risk of extinction over a certain time frame. And so the Fish and Wildlife Service, I mean, they lost 10 times in a row on the same argument. And so it's a foolish argument, but they just tried to say there's no normative element to it. So we're fine because we asked our scientists and our scientists said so. And the court said, no, there's more to it than that. And as you know, the way the courts work is they don't tell you what the right answer is. They just tell you you haven't landed on the right answer and go back and figure it out. And I think what's happened here is that the Fish and Wildlife Service is afraid of what the answer might be. Because here's the thing is that it may be that the Endangered Species Act is taken to be one of the most powerful species-focused acts in the world. But if you believe the interpretation that I'm kind of offering, it's considerably more powerful than has been recognized. And I think that frightens some folks in the Fish and Wildlife Service that might lead to like backlash against the Endangered Species Act. I think that might be, that's a generous interpretation, but it's one you might talk about.
And just when you're thinking about counter opinions, you made, I think, a very compelling case about humans not being the organisms. Mammals that have intrinsic value. Do you find any coherent body arguing against that proposition?
Not coherent. Just, you know, I would say that, you know, if you're interested in the topic, the paper that I had up there where we went through the objections to nature's intrinsic value, those objections, they're all cited in the paper, I mean, they've all been raised by extremely smart people. And so, I mean, genuinely smart people. And so genuinely smart people have been, I just think, confused by the issue. And some of the confusion really does come from, you know, until recently, this notion of intrinsic value was limited to just the technical literature, which is challenging and hard to understand. They don't write well, because they're just writing for the same 6 or 12 people that are studying it. They talk to everyone verbally and on the phone and face-to-face, so they know what they think. It doesn't matter if they write it well or not. And then the rest of us on the outside get confused, I think.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, intrinsic value again. So I'm happy with the intrinsic value of individuals.
Yes.
Troubled by intrinsic value of species, but yeah. How do you justify intrinsic value for ecosystems based on the interests of the ecosystem?
No, I think there's troubles there, and there are two arguments that have been raised for why it is that, if I could just use the word ecological collective, that's a species is an ecological collective, and so is an ecosystem. I'll use that one word. So there have been two arguments that have been raised for why it is that an ecological collective might possess intrinsic value. In the interest of time, I'll tell you just one, because it'll give you some insight as to what the challenges are. The idea is that maybe an ecosystem it's not an organism, but maybe it's sufficiently like an organism, and that's how it inherits its intrinsic value. Say, oh, okay, that's fine. And you got to remember, a lot of this is coming from Aldo Leopold. A lot of this is coming from science. He was inspired by science that was only available to him in 1950. And so what he wrote about, and many people have attached onto, is that, well, ecosystems are homeostatic, and they are resilient. And those are certainly properties of organisms, and maybe those are the properties of organisms that imbue them with intrinsic value. And so if ecosystems are enough like organisms, and that way, that may be how they inherit intrinsic value. The challenge, and many people like that. Many people are fine with that. It's coherent for sure. But the trouble is that many scientists, if you ask them, are ecosystems really well described by their resilience and homeostasis, a lot of them would say no. And so I think what happens is that, and I'm trying to be a little bit generous here, it's a judgment call to say whether two things are similar enough to be in the same category or not. I think it's coherent to say ecosystems have intrinsic value for that reason that I just offered, but I don't think you're obligated to believe it, and you're probably not obligated to believe it because so many scientists say, that's not a good description of how ecosystems work. So that's an example of how the people have worked through logic on this way. And you can see where it has some merit, but you can also see where it has some shortcomings. It's something that more work needs to be done on, for sure.
You might ask whether the planetary ecosystem as a whole has intrinsic value.
Yes,
and,
of course.
It seems like it's useful.
It's useful to us.
Every possible value that humans could have.
Yeah.
Can one not apply some argument like that to ecosystems in general?
Sure. Yeah, no, for sure. And people have kind of worked with this idea a little bit, not a great deal. The first thing to know about the scientist's view of an ecosystem is that their boundaries are arbitrary. So where do you map? Where do you put the boundaries around an ecosystem? That's arbitrary. And so if you remove the arbitrariness, you end up with the planet. And so you know, I think the best adherent, I mean, the best representation of what you're talking about is James Lovelock. James Lovelock, and he's an interesting guy because, of course, he's a very important scientist. And he's also been a very important, actually we should call him a metaphysician more than an ethicist, because he really was talking about how the world is in this metaphysical sort of way. All I can say is, I have some affinities for his metaphysics, but most scientists think he's a kook when it comes to his metaphysics, right? They like his science, but they think his metaphysical conclusions are not right. But that's what scientists think of James Lovelock's metaphysics. If you just start polling people, regular folks, and say, hey, do you think the Earth is like this metaphysically, the way you were describing it, they'd say, yeah, I think so. So there's some complexities there that you definitely have tapped into.
Well, you said the issue of whether to restore predation on an ethical one.
Yeah.
But why are wolves going extinct now at this point after so many years?
Yeah,
genetic
Yeah, no, basically the ecology of what's going on there is the population seems to have depended on having regular immigrants, and those regular, coming once every decade or so, and those regular immigrants depend on those ice bridges, and now that the ice bridges are rare enough, that seems to be what's kind of choking down the frequency with which wolves can come to the island. So here's the ironic thing, is that there are some folks, and these people are very sincere, and very well-intentioned, and they're great conservationists. Some folks would say we should not reintroduce wolves to Isle Royale because Isle Royale is a place where humans should leave their hands off. We should just let nature take its course. We monkey around in nature every other place. We should just have a few places where we let it be. And you tell one of those people, you say, yeah, but humans are the reason that the wolves are going extinct in the first place because it's because of climate change. And their response, with the deepest sincerity, their response, I don't subscribe to it, but I empathize with the intensity of sincerity these people have. They say only an addict to interfering with nature would say that the solution to interfering with nature, climate change, is to interfere with nature again. You just have to stop. These people are very, because what they're concerned with is these people are folks who are really sensitive to ideas of wilderness, which of course is a particularly North American idea in certain forms, of course. And one of the challenges with wilderness in the early 21st century for people who have been really cherishing wilderness is that they believe there's a slippery slope taking it away, just one little thing and then another little thing and another little thing, and they're worried that eventually it'll die a death of 1,000 little pinpricks. And so they just say, stop. Now, there is an ungenerous way to call them, which is just to call them wilderness zealots. And some people do call them that, but they're sincere, misguided.
You're
following
on from in the context of Isle Royale, I mean, it seems like it's a relatively clear-cut question because you have just one species that is going extinct, and you're just asking a simple question about whether or not to back the people who offer this ethical argument against putting them back. It's a complicated one because their argument might not seem to hold so much water in the context of Isle Royale, where everything's very simply distilled. But when you think about the role of restoring ecosystems or moving species as a result of climate change, suddenly their sensibilities about worrying it's a slippery slope become much more pressing. So thinking about moving species from an area where they're currently struggling into a new area where they have never existed, but where they may be better able to cope with the climate change and so forth. We don't know what the impact of bringing that new species into that new system will be. Yeah. Conservation biologists have had a long history of making mistakes in that regard. You can see where their argument of hang on, that says, you know, just in the case of what Isle Royale, maybe it's a good thing, but we'll just have to give up.
I couldn't agree with you more 100% on everything you said, and I think maybe just a couple of things to add to this would be, I in particular agree with you that the Isle Royale case is relatively easy, that I find deeply disturbing, because the federal government, the United States government, has really stumbled with this one. And this is one of the easy ones. The other ones just around the corner are far more difficult. And the other thing that I would just, and this is just kind of echoing the things that you were saying, on the slide that I had where I had the yes and the no, and then I kind of worked them through. I mean, both of those ideas, they both have elements of insight. They're not completely foolish, but they also have serious weaknesses. And so the solution is not to just say, which is why I'm so respectful of the folks the folks that sometimes are called wilderness zealots. Yeah, I hear you then. Let's keep talking about it, because you're not entirely off base. There are places and circumstances where those ideas apply well. And so, yeah, it's complicated.
You speak of wilderness zealots as if they're a minority position in conservation. And there was a talk a few weeks ago regarding Anthropocene, and that more focus should be on speciation and the possibility of speciation exceeds extinction rates. And that it caused a lot of disquiet within the audience, which wouldn't necessarily call themselves conservation zealots. And I'm just wondering if you may speak to some of the ethics regarding the Anthropocene, which was missing in the talk, and what are sort of the implications of human disturbance to ecosystems and what our responsibility might be now for management.
Yeah, I think that, remember the one ago when I said that all ethical arguments have to have a descriptive premise and then an ethical premise? And if you have an ethical if you don't have an ethical premise, the argument is not complete. And what I've been mostly disturbed by with conversations about Anthropocene is that to say, we live in the Anthropocene, therefore, and then who knows what will come out of the person's mouth, because all kinds of things come out of people's mouths. We live in the Anthropocene. We live in the Anthropocene is an empirical premise. It's premise number one. We live in the, and you can elaborate on whatever it is that you think it means that we live in the Anthropocene means. But then you can't jump to your conclusion. Where are the ethical premises? You have to work those through. And so what I've been disturbed by is that when you read about people who are talking about the Anthropocene, is they come up with all kinds of conclusions from that first premise. And they're often very, very much contradictory. And they're not working through, okay, so, but you gotta work a little harder on why does that empirical circumstance lead to that conclusion? There's more to the argument that hasn't shown to us. So, that's kind of what I think.
But I think that we should draw this to a close now, because the opportunity to continue to chat with John over drinks next door, at the beginning, we anticipated hearing about some interesting. And we anticipated hearing a little bit about logic. I think the two together are not only exhilarating, but actually beautiful. And it's been a privilege.
Thanks so much.